are listening to The Nerd Show here on 1190 AM, streaming online, iHeartRadio.com, keyword 1190 AM, Dallas, Fort Worth. See, what's great is that when I'm in here by myself here in the studio, I can blare the music as loud as I want, which is awesome. I love that sax riff. That's brilliant. I love it. All right, we're talking more Akon 25. We're going to be catching up with Patrick Scott Patterson, the original PSP. Christy and Thaddeus were able to sit down with him last week while they were at Akon 25. So here is that interview.
Hi, this is Christy, and I'm here with Thaddeus, where you're listening to The Nerd Show. We're here at the Hilton Anatole in Dallas. We're at Akon 25. We've got Patrick Scott Patterson joining us. Hello.
How are you? Good morning, good afternoon, whatever it is. It's hi.
I'm not real sure. We're all pretty tired here. So you are huge into video games. Can you tell me, like, you know, when your first exposure to video games was and, like, you know, what made you kind of want to get into it in the first place?
Well, I can tell it's almost like it was yesterday. I was just a little bit shy. 6 years old. It's going way back, by the way. So this is 1981 now we're going. And it was at a laundromat in my hometown, Garland, Texas. And my mom, who was there trying to wash clothes, told me to go sit down and shut up over next to this big yellow box with cartoon characters on it. That was Pac-Man. You see, I have Pac-Man. I'm always wearing Pac-Man on me somewhere because that was that moment where, you know, some things stick with you, some things don't. And that's something
you always remember your first love.
I can still picture exactly where that machine sat in there, everything that was going on around me, everything. And, of course, I asked her for a quarter, got one, put it in, and that's when I discovered video games. And, you know, as I grew up, I never lost that love for them.
That's very cool. And then how were you able to continuously transition? Because I'm not sure, you know, I occasionally would get the old parental standby of like, those video games will rot your brain and you should go read a book and stuff like that. So obviously you had a mother who was supportive enough to hand you that first quarter.
Well, she was supportive enough to hand that first quarter. But yeah, like my teenage years, I got that same thing too.
Right,
you know,
right.
You know, the Nintendo this or that. But it was kind of hard for them to really argue it for two reasons. One, they'd come home from work, and I was, sure enough, I was on the Nintendo, but my chores were done, my homework was done, so they got nothing. But number two is around that same age, I started not just wanting to learn about the games themselves as far as playing them and find the tricks and the Easter eggs and all that,
right,
but I started getting books from the libraries and from used bookstores, stuff like that, because I wanted to know about the people who made these games. I wanted to know about the history of these games, the history of these companies, the history of that industry. At that point in time, it was still new enough. It really wasn't history, but it was a backstory.
Right.
And so ever since that, I started learning that, and when my parents would try to bring up things like that, like, oh, this or that, I would cite some sort of thing from 1977 that, like, yo, they said the same thing then, and then this proved it, and they had nothing.
So you just became your own video game encyclopedia, which is just sort of...
Well, it's just like there's people who love film so much that they don't want to just learn about the movies and watch the movies and recite the lines, and that's fun.
Right.
But they want to learn about the history of these movies and the directors and the producers and these actors and all this stuff. And they, you know, same thing with sports. There are people out there that they can tell you the batting average of every New York Yankee known to man off the top of their head. I'm the video game version of those people.
Excellent. So when did that crossover happen for you where that became a hobby versus, hey, I can actually, you know, start doing this and making money for it?
I kind of fell into it a little bit. For a long time, I, like a lot of people in video gaming, were very frustrated with what you see in the mainstream with it. Where, you know, they'll have people go on, they'll have the guy with the bad haircut go on and tell you what video games aren't, but that's the only expert they bring on. And it was actually 5 years ago this year, almost exactly. I kind of fell into it almost by accident. I was working with a gaming organization at the time that G4 asked if we would be interested in doing something with them at E3, which was Steve Wiebe going for the Donkey Kong World Record live. And I'm the person they contacted, and I'm the person on that side of things that pushed it and pushed it and pushed it. And my role kept growing bigger and bigger and bigger, where it went from being a guy who happened to call to me actually getting a producer credit for that whole thing.
Oh, that's very
cool.
Because
as I got there, these people didn't know about the history of the game, about what it was to compete on that game. And they actually even flew my own machine out there, all that. And so they were so happy with what I was able to bring to them that it made me go, man, all this stuff that I used to get picked on for studying, and all of that combined with what I learned. I was a wrestler for 10 years. What I learned with that about timing out TV and connecting with an audience. Mm-hmm. I was a journalism major, and what I learned with that. And it's like all of this stuff kind of combined is like, and I can do this sort of thing. So being frustrated about why there's not a video game expert in the media to go to for that, that goes, tries to go for that mainstream bubble, right. Not just the video vlogs. Not that there's anything wrong with that, too.
No, but not at all.
Goes outside of that. It's like no one else is wanting to do that, but why can't I do that? I saw right there where a major television network, I had tangible value to them. None of them there could do what I did by their own words.
Right.
So it's like, for lack of a better thing, like, why don't I try to be this?
Right, and that actually rolls right into my question, which was going to be how does connecting that into mainstream media to become a video game expert / advocate, or in the world of political, if we were talking about politics, you would be a political pundit. Instead, you are a video game pundit, which is brilliant. The fact that there is such a lack of them.
Yeah.
In this world.
Well, and it's frustrating because it's been the same narrative for so long. A lot of times they try to, you know, like the, let's say the violent video game debate. Let's say debate with quotation marks because you only hear one side of it on TV.
Right. It's all these kids are doing terrible things because of Doom and
but
this
that's
and that.
Gone, yeah. That debate, quote unquote, has gone on since 1976. You know, it's just each generation. Then it all gets forgotten about and kind of resets, and they keep going and keep going and keep going. I think the reason why they do is because no one has been able to stand up that they're going to take seriously anyway to say you were wrong, or at least let me counterpoint you on this. Let us get our side of this out there. So it's like trying to aim for that, but it's just because that isn't like an established thing. I mean, if I said I was a celebrity chef, instantly they're going to be like, yeah, we know what that is. They get it, okay?
Right.
But since this isn't like an established thing, it's kind of trying to push this, I often describe it as pushing a very heavy boulder up a very, very steep hill.
Right.
You know, to where, and it's like that because if I stop pushing, it's going to start to roll back. It's going to run me over on the way down.
Right.
So I got to at least hold steady and just push and push. And it's 7 days a week, all day, dawn to dusk, pushing and trying to get this stuff out there and try to get the media to understand. And a lot of that's going to events like this to where it's like maybe I won't get as many opportunities as I like in the mainstream media yet. I do get a consistent enough of them. But events like this, it'll give me the platform to speak about those things. And then, of course, then I can go back to the media. And then I can be like, I'm booked to speak at these events about this. I'm in these films, documentary films about video games where I talk about this stuff. You know, my qualifications start to speak for themselves, and it opens their ears up enough.
Right.
And that's the biggest trick is just if I'm convinced, still convinced, from past experience, I've already seen it to where when they do give me a chance to speak on this, that I blow their minds. It's getting them to look and listen long enough because they're convinced this is something a bunch of young boys do that are introverts and it's this geeky little niche thing, and it's not. It's mainstream entertainment. It deserves a respect to mainstream entertainment. Right. It's getting them to listen, and they're not going to listen on their own.
Right. And, you know, I feel like as far as, reactions in the media, I feel like video games are honestly the new rock and roll. You know, in the 50s, rock and roll was going to cause kids to have sex and do drugs.
They're going
to
be dancing.
Yeah, they're going to be doing bad things. And, you know, I think that's pretty fantastic that you are actually starting to stand up for this because not many people have so far, and also have the qualifications of, you know, being pretty much an expert on it.
Right. And to that end, what do you feel has been some of the biggest pushback, I would say, media-wise, that you've received when actually getting the chance to enter the debates in a more uniform fashion? Like, what?
Well, the problem is that they've already been fed this one narrative, you know? And she brought up rock and roll. Another one was comic books, books in general, television, movies. There's even the internet recently, something pulled out where it was like from the 1800s somewhere, it talked about chess and the warnings of children, the possible delinquent behavior because of the time that they need to spend to become proficient at chess is taking away from more traditional, wholesome activities.
Oh, my goodness.
And there always seems to be those those things, but eventually they go away. They never go away organically.
Yeah.
But the problem is, it's this decades of things where you get some psychology expert, and they're like, yes, we know about video games, this and this and this, and it's literally just almost kind of grabbing them by the shirt collar and being like, look, listen. And sometimes they literally don't want to hear it. When Sandy Hook went down, as I often do, I'm calling news desks. I'm calling national news desks. Right. And I'm just saying, this deserves equal time. Video games getting thrown under the bus. And obviously, while I'm volunteering myself for it, I'm even trying to make it clear that if it's not me, I can give you a list of people, guys like Adam Sessler and stuff like this, that please bring somebody on to counterpoint this. And most of them were cordial. You know, they didn't actually do it, but one, I'll actually go into it, was Fox News, told me, quote unquote, we are not interested in pursuing that angle on the story at this time. So they're basically telling me, while they had numerous, I mean, almost two or three times daily for weeks there, about that, they were not interested in pursuing the other side of that debate. It's like they were so convinced that they were right, or so convinced that that's the narrative they wanted to feed, that they didn't even want to entertain the idea of that.
That there would be something contrary to what they were reporting.
Yeah.
That no, clearly this is fact and it's undisputable.
Yeah, where it's like, yeah, and that's what it is. And even another thing, I mean, me and my partner Rachel, we did a panel here last night on the violent video game debate. It's our side of it.
Mm-hmm.
For the second year in a row, I mean, I was sent formal press invitations to Glenn Beck, who is 20 minutes down the road. Right, this is where studios. Yep. He recently said, Call of Duty trains kids to kill. And he even said, Watch Dogs is training our children to hack, which is ridiculous. I am on him all the time.
You say to audible size from Thaddeus and
well,
I.
But I am on him. Well, I think I live here locally, since he's so close. All the time I'm saying, I'll go down to your studio and I'll counterpoint you, or I go to an event like this, I would like you to come. I want to have a debate. We're going to have a cordial, professional debate. Right. I'm confident in my side of this. Are you or are you not? So last night, we actually had a chair and a mic set up for him. I actually had a little thing of water sitting there for him. I announced him, and then, oh, wait, he's not here. Because that's the problem. They are not willing to listen to that side. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's almost like when you're a kid and you feel like, you know, the grown-ups won't listen to you, but you're actually trying to tell them something real that later on they're like, oh, why didn't you tell me? I tried. That's what it feels like. Only now I'm a 38-year-old man, and I make my living talking about video games, and some of them still don't want to take it seriously enough to even bother to listen.
Right. And I feel like a lot of that is, I feel like people think that opening up their minds and changing their opinion is admitting defeat or saying that they're wrong, which is, it's not that at all. They can, I mean, just changing their mind, they can say, you know, I was wrong before, but that's not a bad thing because you've changed your mind since then. So,
well the other thing too is that there are a lot of times they're trying to use it as a scapegoat, which I think is the bigger problem. Beck recently, when he brought it back to video games again, he started off by saying, well, they're trying to blame the guns, but why don't we talk about this? NRA's Wayne LaPierre did that after Sandy Hook, mm-hmm. where they were trying to make a big thing about guns. He tried to throw video games under the bus, not because I think he necessarily believed it, but because he was trying to get the heat off of him.
Right.
And to me, it's still scapegoating into another thing when the problem is actually the fact, how about the fact this person went and shot people? Once upon a time, people were blamed for actions when people did things.
Right.
You know, we live in a society now where if someone gets fat off McDonald's, they blame McDonald's instead of the person who went up to McDonald's and ordered food that anyone knows is unhealthy for them.
Right.
When I was a kid, if my grades slipped, my parents got on me. They didn't get on my teacher. They didn't get on the superintendent. And the thing is, these scapegoating things create problems. That sort of thing's been a headache for McDonald's. That sort of thing creates headaches for our education system. And this sort of thing creates headaches for the video game industry and the video game retailers and all of those things where it's like, let's get the focus on the problem. Let's get our politicians to quit focusing on trying to pass video game taxes based on things that don't exist anyway, that aren't proven, and wasting their time and taxpayer dollars and time that they could be spending addressing the actual issues that cause a person to go do a violent act because it's not a video game.
Right.
No.
And what do you think has been So I guess Glenn Beck is sort of your relative nemesis, just because he's local. Or do you have like is there anybody in particular who has truly been, I guess, arguably unprofessional at their approach at like any, like, has anybody directly attacked you for trying to speak up? Or
well, not within the mainstream media, at least not directly yet. It's still trying to be like, you know, look at this, you know, I've spoken at Comic-Con and South by Southwest, and I'm in these movies. My qualifications speak for themselves. I've been invited to Stanford University for a video game thing. Clearly, you can't ignore that. But there's actually some people within the gaming communities, mm-hmm. too, that for some reason, I guess, they think I should be spending my time talking about PS4 versus Xbox One frame rates like 100,000 other people do, and being like, you know, oh, well, just they don't know what they're talking about. Ignore them. Just let them be their thing. I'm like, that's the problem.
Right.
Because while we all just roll our eyes, there's a politician somewhere that decides, well, we're going to try and pass this, and the taxpayers lose. That's taxpayer dollars they're spending pursuing that. That person's earning taxpayer money paycheck, wasting their time on trying to pass a violent video game tax.
Well, and somebody who legitimately has a vote on some level, or somebody who legitimately has the ability to affect legal change within
because I mean, if one of those passed and you had to pay a little bit extra to buy a rated M or even a rated T game like some have proposed, or if let's say one of these that tries to criminalize sale of a rated M game to a child, like their cigarettes or alcohol or drugs, which is a comparison I hate.
Wow.
Because a lot of them do compare them to drugs and say, they always say they're addicted to video games, which it's like, no, you know, they're not. They're not, you know, I mean, if someone watches a Breaking Bad marathon on Netflix all day, you don't say they're addicted to television. They're just a big fan of that show, and they have time to kill that day. But, you know, let's say one of those laws passed, it would affect everybody. It would affect how these games are sold, how they're marketed, even how they're created. Mm-hmm. You know, and video games aren't this kid's toy anymore, which is what the media keeps missing. The average age of a gamer today is 31 years old.
Right.
And it's okay for us to have movies made for adults. It's okay for us to have television shows made for adults. It's okay for us to have books that are made for adults. But it's not okay for us to have video games made for adults. They would sure dislike it if those rated M games had to become far and few in between, because retailers like Walmart wouldn't want to carry something that had a potential criminal issue if it was sold like that. They wouldn't want to even carry them.
Right.
Or they would want them deeply censored, or whatever. Right, it would affect the entire marketplace.
Yeah, it's something that they already do. It's known that they already do with music to a degree, things that have specific content on, and Walmart will sort of shy away from.
Absolutely. To a degree. Absolutely.
Which is their prerogative in the world of capitalism and business, but at the same time, yeah, it's got to be a really scary thing for the industry, gaming-wise, to have somebody really pushing for something like
that. And unfortunately, sometimes there's people in the gaming communities that they think I'm directing my energy too much towards that and not enough towards the other things. Like, look, y'all, all that's covered. I mean, we're about to go to E3, and there's going to be 100,000 articles that talk about the new Madden.
Right.
That's great. I'm going to go check it out myself, but that's not gonna, you know, there's enough people doing that. There's things to talk about over here too, and it affects all of that stuff.
Right. Well, I mean, it's the same reason why, movies aren't usually rated anything over R, because theaters won't even carry them. And then,
great example.
It affects how everything's going to be made. That kind of thing.
That's a great example of that, because sometimes those filmmakers can't really tell the story they want,
right?
Because they've still got to tone it down to enough. Because you're exactly as you say, you know, most theaters are not going to carry an NC-17 film or whatever.
Right.
They're not going to do it for obvious business and liability reasons.
Right.
Same thing could happen to video games if some of these crazy laws get passed, or and not that any of them have, but who's to say they're not going to at some point?
And they're
going to keep trying to feed that as long as they believe that's what's actually going on.
Now, on the opposite end of the pushback, what's some of the highest praise you've received so far in trying to champion sort of video game rights and you know, at least open up people's minds to the debate of, like, video games do not automatically equal evil?
Well, I mean, I've had respect and support from some pretty high people within the industry. I mentioned Adam Sessler earlier. He came last year and sat on a panel with me about this. I invited him. I was like, he's going to be at that event anyway. And I was like, I'm going to speak on this. He needs to come. And you know, that was, you know, he gets what I'm doing. A lot of former G4 talent, they understand and respect and support what I'm doing. They see the need for it. Some of the spokesperson for the ESA, Rich Taylor, he makes sure that I know what's going on, and he's given me compliments and stuff like that. But the biggest thing is when we go do something in a panel like this, and people come and we spend more time almost interacting with the people out there than talking to them, because they already agree with us. It's the fact that they look to, like me and Rachel, to be voices for them on this topic. So when we do get those opportunities, when they do come up, we're not just speaking for our point of view, we're speaking for them, kind of like a voice of the voiceless type of thing.
Right.
I never asked that, or certainly I never named myself something like that. It's just that they started coming and being like, this is our guy, this is our voice. And when something like that runs on the air, I'll go to Twitter, I'll call out the person doing it, and my audience on there, a lot of times they'll speak up. And too, people were bugging Glenn Beck on Twitter the other day saying,
nice,
we want to see this happen. They're even like, we will buy tickets to see this happen. We want to see this happen. They're tweeting to him because, you know, and that's the greatest compliment there is, because those people are saying, this guy right here, this guy's speaking for us on this. Please listen to him and give him a chance.
That's awesome. Do you have any favorite questions from the forum last night? Did anybody have anything particularly outstanding that sort of made you smile? Or
it's always a mixed bag. Like I said, one thing about this is while we do get our platform and we speak on this, at the same time, we are, you know, there, we have kind of a sympathetic audience and what have you. But sometimes they're ones that are given good ideas. Like,
right,
one of them is like, you know, the ESRB rating system. It's there. It's in effect. Everyone should know it, but it's not, like, everyone knows the MPAA.
Yeah.
Everyone knows what rated R means. For some reason, video games don't get that same thing.
Right.
And them giving me input like that, that gives me something to go and say to somebody else, such as the ESA. And it's like, this is what some of these gamers, they're seeing out of this. And maybe that can affect the change that comes along with it. And then, of course, we always get some people that try to bring that devil, you know, we're going to play the devil's advocate, and we're going to do this. And then, of course, they trip over themselves. And they, you know, I think sometimes they just try to do it just to try to make it an argumentative thing.
Right.
And then I smoke them. So that's
right. Well, what I mean, the violence in video games and everything like that, that's kind of a hot topic in the media. Well, one of the things that I was reading about you here, and you speak about, or you speak against and fight against stereotypes of video gaming. Now, is that just violence, or do you also deal with stereotypes within video gaming? And if so, what kind of a forum do you have for that? Because I know that's really not covered by any sort of media.
Well, I mean, it means it pretty much whatever that means. I hate this stigma that video games are still a kid's thing. I hate that it's still seen as a thing for males or boys, a lot of times, as they'll put it out there. I hate the fact that there's people that try to label, both inside and outside of gaming, try to label gamers as certain types of this. You're not a real gamer because you don't do this, or, you know, gamers are these introverted this or that, and that there's so much infighting within. You know, that also includes transgenders as well. I mean, anything. It's like, it's getting people both in gaming and out of it to realize we're all gamers. To be honest with you, I almost wouldn't even mind if the gamer label itself maybe went away.
Right.
Because you don't see that in any other form of entertainment. You know, you don't, there's not a TV-er.
Right.
There's not a movie-er. There's not,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
you're not a real movie fan unless you've watched this movie six times. That doesn't exist. Or
right,
movies are enjoyed by this. You go to a movie theater, and it's people from all demographics and all walks of life, and they're able to just enjoy the film.
Right.
Now, maybe some of them go to the internet afterwards and going, the CGI effects were slightly this or that. But you know, they're still able to enjoy movies. It's seen as a broad-based entertainment and that sort of thing. And it's the same thing with gaming. I want to see video gaming enjoyed, not analyzed so much. And the stereotypes are a big part of that. There's too much assumption about this or that, or you didn't play this game, you know, whatever, or the people that play on their devices, the people that play on their iPhones or iPads, they're just as much video gamers as anyone else.
Right.
Or the stereotype that the mainstream's trying to get in, when it's really the case that it became mainstream from the inside out.
Mm-hmm.
Accept it, realize it. I mean, it's just whatever that means. To me, video gamers, they're of all ages, genders, orientations, religions. Can't we just get around to just enjoying what this is?
There you go. Well, one more thing. I did want to ask you about the films that you're set to appear in. The NES Club and No Princess in the Castle. Can you tell me a little bit more about your role within those?
Well, and those are just two of several of them. The NES Club, which is the closest one, I believe, to coming out, it's kind of a dual story. One, it's about a guy named Jay, who's up in Canada. He is a product of the NES generation. He's trying to go around North America and complete the entire licensed collection of NES games without going to the internet, no Craigslist, no eBay, just going, doing it old school, going to used game stores and antique things, going to collections, and him going on this road trip about this just to see if it could be done. Mm-hmm. But along the way, they're visiting with people that are also products of that generation. Some of them are in industry, some of them are in the media, same thing, or just fans, some are world record holders, that sort of thing, and interacting with them. So they filmed with me twice. Mm-hmm. One, which was at San Diego Comic-Con last year, where they kind of got my insight and opinion on what the Nintendo Entertainment System meant and the impact that it had and the legacy that it had. And then they came down through Texas, and I took them around Denton, which is where I live. I took them around to some of my little secret places and some of the antique malls and some of the little hidden things in town on a hunt. We actually found a couple, too, which was exciting.
Excellent.
Because it was late in his journey, and I'm like, ooh, wow, they've already gotten X amount of the list. Yeah. It's starting to get the uncommons. The fact that we found some, first, that guarantees I won't get cut. But secondly, it ensures that I'm going, I helped him along his way and made that an interesting part of the journey. And I believe that's supposed to drop a soft drop right around October this year. And then they're going to have like a 6-month window. Then they're going to start getting distribution on some of the digital networks and stuff out there and the Netflixes.
So they're doing festival release first?
Yeah, that. And then they'll direct sell like a basic DVD of it. And then the distribution site will come later and it'll have more. Another one is No Princess in the Castle. That just got funded through a very stressful crowdfunding campaign where we took a lot of heat for just the subject matter in general. People, a lot of them misunderstanding. They're thinking this is going to be some man-hating, radical feminist type of thing when it's just happens to be aiming to tell the stories of women that are in video game industry and video game culture without having to proclaim them and be like, look, they're women and they're pretty and this and that or whatever. Oh, they're just freaking people.
Sounds like my kind of movie.
just telling it like that. That's our aim. That's our goal with it. Of course, people are going to make assumptions about anything before they see it.
Right.
But that's coming out. I'm one of the co-writers in that film, and also I'm going to appear in the film in some capacity, often really to try to do what I do to help tell the stories of these people who are being featured in the movie. What got them into gaming? Much like the first question you asked me, what got them into gaming? What does it mean to them? What their accomplishments and their victories and their defeats have been along the way? And just paint the picture, tell their story as people.
Right.
And they just happen to be women, because we've seen a lot of video game documentaries. How many of them have had that many women in it so far?
Correct.
So this is just kind of trying to balance that out a little bit, but without having to be like, yay, girl power type of thing or whatever. They're people.
Truly approaching it on an equal scale.
Yeah.
Rather than just, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the title is No Princess in the Castle. It's trying to basically state that, the women in this, they're not the little, the princess in the castle that needs anyone to come do anything for them.
Right, we're not the reward. You're themselves. Not anything like that. Yeah,
absolutely.
All right. Well, thank you so much. I appreciate you joining us. This has been Patrick Scott Patterson here on the Nerd Show. This is Thaddeus and Christy. We are here at Acon 25 at the Hilton Anatole in Dallas.
Hey nerds, Glenn here. You're listening to the Nerd Show Rewind. Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/TheNerdShow.
This is Patrick Scott Patterson, the original PSP, and you are listening to The Nerd Show.